Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. First of all, I would like to thank the organizing committee, and I would like to welcome all my professors and colleagues from all over Egypt, منورين اسكندريه. بشكر دكتور محمد الحقيقه اداني موضوع صعب شويه Endothelial Dysfunction, فمعظم التوك هيكون على السيلولار ليفل, فاتمنى ان احاول ابسطه على قد ما اقدر ان شاء الله. Our agenda today will discuss endothelial functions, endothelial dysfunction, about definition, pathophysiology, assessment, and endothelial dysfunction in human diseases. And our main topic will be endothelial dysfunction in the kidney and what are the potential therapies targeting endothelial dysfunction. Endothelial functions include regulation of vascular tone, maintaining hemostasis balance, anti-inflammatory function, regulation of smooth muscle cell growth. In normal conditions, when the endothelial cells are stimulated, they would secrete nitric oxide and prostacycline, causing vasodilatation. Also, in normal conditions, they would secrete anti-thrombotic substances, such as nitric oxide, prostacycline, thrombomodulin, tissue factor inhibitor, tissue plasminogen activator. Also, they have anti-inflammatory function through decreased level of adhesion and chemoattractant molecules, such as E-selectin, ICAM1, VCAM1, and MCP1. Also, in healthy states, they have anti-proliferative properties by releasing anti-proliferative substances such as nitric oxide and prostacycline. What about endothelial dysfunction? Endothelial dysfunction is defined when there is shift in the actions of endothelium towards reduced vasodilatation, a pro-inflammatory state, and pro-thrombotic properties. It is associated with most forms of cardiovascular diseases such as hypertension, coronary artery disease, chronic heart failure, peripheral vascular disease, diabetes, chronic kidney disease, and severe viral infections. What about the pathophysiology? When there is endothelial dysfunction, when the endothelial cells are stimulated, they will secrete vasoconstrictors instead of the vasodilators. Vasoconstrictors such as endothelin 1, thromboxane A2, prostaglandin, and angiotensin 2. Also, when there is endothelial dysfunction, they will release inflammatory molecules and endocytic receptors, causing increased endothelial permeability. Also, they will secrete, instead of anticoagulants, they will secrete prothrombotic and antifibrinolytic factors, such as endothelin 1, thromboxane E2, reactive oxygen species, tissue factor, von Willebrand factor, fibrinogen, plasminogen activator inhibitor. Also, in inflammation, as we said before, they now secrete more adhesion and chemoattractant molecules. Also, they will secrete proliferative factors such as platelet-derived growth factor, angiotensin 2, endothelin 1, and vascular endothelial growth factor. This is a figure summarizing what we said now about increasing and decreasing substances released from endothelium according to whether in the healthy state or in the diseased state. As we see above, in normal conditions, when there is shear stress, it will induce nitric oxide synthase, and there is preserved glycocalyx, which is formed of mainly proteoglycans, and there is also repair by endothelial progenitor cells. While in pro-inflammatory or diseased states, there is activation with reactive oxygen species generation, reduced nitric oxide availability, release of endothelial microparticles, activating complement pathway, releasing tissue factor, and causing coagulation. There is also increased expression of adhesion molecules, attracting monocytes and other neutrophils, with detachment of circulating endothelial cells, and there is reduced repair of endothelial cells. How can we assess endothelial function? Assessment is divided into vessel wall assessment and serum markers. And vessel wall assessment includes invasive procedures and non-invasive procedures. Invasive include infusion of acetylcholine into the coronary arteries has been shown to produce a paradoxical vasoconstriction in those arteries affected by atheroma. In healthy conditions, when acetylcholine is infused into the coronaries, it will stimulate nitric oxide release and causing vasodilatation. While when there is endothelial dysfunction, acetylcholine will cause direct vasoconstriction due to reduced nitric oxide release. I am going back for these non-invasive measures. I will describe the mechanism for all of them at once. الفكرة بتاعتهم كلها ان احنا في الاول في البروسيجر ان هو بيندوس اسكيميا غالبا عن طريق بيعمل كف بيقفل البلاد سبلاي وبيعمل اسكيميا بعد كده بيريموف الكف وبعد كده بيحصل رياكتيف هايبرينيا. الهايبرينيا اللي بتحصل بتزود البلاد فلو والبلاد فلو بيستيميوليت يعمل شير ستريس ويستيميليت الاندوثيليال نيتريك اوكسايد سينثيز وريليز النيتريك اوكسايد، يحصل فازو دايلاتيشن. الفازو دايلاتيشن ده هيحصل فيه زياده في البلاد فلو، فوزر ان هو بيقيس الدايامتر ان هو بيزيد نتيجه النيتريك اوكسايد اللي زاد، فبالتالي ده يكون انتاكت اندوثيليوم، او بيشوف الفوليوم تشينج اللي حصل في الاورجان ده، وبالتالي لما يزيد الفوليوم يكون ده انتاكت اندوثيليوم وريليز نيتريك اوكسايد. دي الفكره كلها. اهم واحد الفلو ميديتد دايلاتيشن. الفلو ميديتد دايلاتيشن از ذا موست كومنلي يوزد ميثود فور ميجرينج اندوثيليال ديسفانكشن ميلي بيكوز اوف اتس سنسيتيفيتي اند نون انفيزيف نيتشر. ات از بيسد اون ذا اندوثيليال ريليز اوف نيتريك اوكسايد and other endothelial relaxing factor response to increase in shear stress. And this occurs when the forearm blood flow increases during reactive hyperemia that follows a brief period of transient ischemia in the distal arteriole. ده الشكل التست. ادي الكاف اللي احنا قلنا بتعمل ischemia، وادي الالتراساوند probe، وادي بعد كده بيشوف ال diameter of the brachial artery، وبيشوف ال change في ال diameter ده as a percentage. ال cut-off point بيكون 8%. لو اكتر من 8% يبقى ده intact endothelium، لو اقل من كده يبقى فيه endothelial dysfunction. ال measurement of flow mediated dilatation can stratify individuals at low, moderate or high risk for future cardiometabolic events, but it has few limitations: lack of standardization and variations في cuff placement or position. The degree of reactive hyperemia ممكن تختلف من person للتاني، وبيكون طبعا variations في the structure of blood vessels، وبتكون mainly observer dependent. اللي بعد كده الفينوس اوكلوجن بالثيزموجرافي. من الاسم فينوس اوكلوجن، هنا بيعمل الكاف بنستيميوليت بس مش لدرجه زي الفلو ميديتد دايليتيشن ما بنعملش اسكيميا. هنا بيكون الانفليشن لدرجه ان هو يقفل بس الفينوس فلو، وبعد كده بيشوف بالثيزموجرافي ان هو بيشوف الفوليوم تشينجز. فهنا ادي الصوره الكاف، وبعد كده وادي في جوج، دي المشكله ان هي انفيزيف شويه، دي اللي بتشوف الفوليوم تشينجز. هنا الانفليشن بريسر يوزد is sufficient to arrest the venous return without impairing the arterial flow towards the forearm, causing a linear increase in blood flow. This is measured by a strain gauge which detects any changes في tissue volume على مستوى ال forearm. The vessel responsiveness is assessed by evaluation of volume changes in the limb in response to a mechanical stimulus that promotes reactive hyperemia. A decreased or impaired response may be evidence of endothelial dysfunction, which is considered a critical factor for the development, progression, and the complications of coronary artery disease. بعد كده الـ peripheral arterial tonometry, the same mechanism, cuff, بس هنا بيشوف الـ volume changes مش في الـ forearm، بيشوفه على مستوى الـ fingers. وهنا بيشوف ان البلاد بلسطايل فوليوم تشينجز ار يوزد از ا سيرجت فور بيسلاين بلاد فلو جيفن ذا بريفيرال فلو ديبندز اون ذا سمول فيسل تون. ذيس بروسيجرز ار نون از بريفيرال ارتيريال تون ميجرز. انذر ميثود ويتش از ليزر دوبلر فلو ميتري، ودي بتشوف برضه السيركيوليشن بس على المايكروفاسكولار ليفل، على الكيوتينيوس مايكرو سيركيوليشن. اخر واحد البلس ويف فيلوسيتي. At the end of the ventricular ejection, a pressure wave propagates from the heart to the periphery at certain velocity. This velocity is known as pulse wave velocity. Some authors have defined pulse wave velocity as the distance traveled by blood flow divided by the time taken to travel the distance. في الغالب بيشوف ما بين الهارت عند الأورطة والفيمورال، بيشوف المسافة والوقت اللي أخدته البلس ويف. Has been used as an important marker for cardiovascular risk. Pulse wave velocity values are lower in healthy young individuals but increase with age as the elastic properties of blood vessels decrease. The cutoff value of pulse wave velocity for prediction of cardiovascular event is still controversial, but a value greater than 12 meters per second has been used as an indicator of cardiovascular risk. Now we go for markers. The most important marker used for endothelial dysfunction is ADMA. ADMA is asymmetric dimethyl arginine, which is an endogenous competitive inhibitor of nitric oxide synthase. ADMA is derived from hydrolysis of proteins containing methylated arginine. ADMA inhibits nitric oxide synthesis by competing with a substrate of nitric oxide L-arginine, leading to endothelial dysfunction and atherosclerosis. Also, it has been considered as independent risk factor for cardiovascular disease. Elevated ADMA concentration is highly prevalent in various disease states, including in the stage renal disease, diabetes, hypercholesterolemia, hyperhomocysteinemia, hypertension, and cardiovascular diseases. Clearance of ADMA is either by renal elimination or by enzymatic degradation. This scheme is very important عشان هنستخدمه كتير. بيتصنع الأول من الـ-arginine الأدمة، يحصل له methylation يكون dimethyl arginine، بعد كده يحصل proteolysis يكون الأدمة asymmetric dimethyl L-arginine. الادما هو بيعتبر كومبيتيتيف انهيبيتور للاندوثيليال نيتروك اوكسايد سينثيز. النيتروك اوكسايد بيتصنع من الارجينين, وبالتالي لما يحصل كومبيتيتيف انهيبيشن للنيتروك اوكسايد ديكريز ويل بي ديكريز ليدنج تو اندوثيليال ديسفانكشن. الادما زي ما قلنا بيحصل له ديجريديشن باي انزيماتيك ديجريديشن اور اكسكريتد ان يورين. The next one is oxidized LDL, low-density lipoproteins. As we all know, oxidized LDL is produced by oxidative processes during LDL migration through the blood vessel wall and has been suggested as a marker of endothelial function and atherogenesis. Oxidized LDL and nitric oxide exert contradictory actions. الصورة مش واضحة قوي. إنما في النورمال endothelium, nitric oxide causing vasodilatation, growth inhibition, and is anti-apoptotic, while in endothelial dysfunction, oxidized LDL causing vasoconstriction, growth stimulation, and pro-apoptotic. Endothelial microparticles, they are small vesicles released from endothelial cells on activation. They, normally, they are rarely found, while in endothelial dysfunction, they are increased. Cell adhesion molecules can be used as a marker for endothelial dysfunction. Inflammatory markers such as CRB and CD4 ligand, interleukin 18, and MCP1 have been used for endothelial assessment. This summarizes for what we had said. Endothelial dysfunction in human diseases. Dysfunction is thought to play a major role in the development of atherosclerosis, angiogenesis, vascular leakage, and infectious diseases. This summary, I will skip it for our main topic, endothelial dysfunction and the kidney. This is a very nice review article published this year in the Nature Reviews about endothelial structure and function. In the kidney, we have three types of endothelial cells. The first type is present in medium and large vessels, which is continuous, confluent, connected by intercellular junctions, and elongated, which help in the, for the management of blood flow. Second one is present in glomeruli, which are highly fenestrated and are covered on their luminal surface by thick glycocalyx, which is very important for the glomerular filtration barrier. Third one for in the inner peritubular capillaries, which are fenestrated, covered by thin diaphragm, and helps for the reabsorption and secretion of fluids from adjacent tubular epithelial cells. As we see here, the first type in the medial, in medium and large vessels, they are connected, not fenestrated, while in glomeruli, these endothelial cells, they are fenestrated and covered by thick glycocalyx, while third one, peritubular capillaries, also are fenestrated. These varied functions of endothelial cells make them key drivers and targets of inflammatory and thrombotic processes that can damage the kidney. For example, in common diseases such as diabetes, hypertension, and in rare diseases such as atypical HUS and glomerulonephritis related to systemic diseases and in association with AKI. The accumulation of uremic toxins that occur with kidney dysfunction contribute to endothelial dysfunction and cardiovascular burden of patients with CKD. The transition of renal endothelial cells towards a mesenchymal phenotype in a process called endothelial to mesenchymal transition promotes renal fibrosis and development of CKD. Systemic endothelial dysfunction and accelerated atherosclerosis resulting from CKD might accelerate decline of renal function. Now we will discuss the pathogenesis of endothelial damage in kidney diseases. Few diseases that cause direct endothelial injuries like typical HUS, lupus nephritis, or antibody-mediated rejection. With diseases بتحصل نتيجة defective endothelial protection زي الاتيبيكال اتش يو اس والبري اكلامسيا والانتي في جي اف ثيرابي, وفي ديزيز بتحصل في الدي كي دي والهايبرتنشن. So first one is typical اتش يو اس. As we all know, this is the endothelial cell. How it's injured, this shiga toxin bind to globotriceramide, causing endocytosis, inhibition of protein synthesis with release of B cell lectin and activation of complement pathway. At the end, causing release of von Willebrand factor and platelet aggregation. In lupus nephritis, there is antibodies directed against endothelial antigens, or there is trapping of circulating immune complexes, causing endothelial cell activation and the recruitment of inflammatory cells. While in antiphospholipid syndrome, there is antibodies directed against endothelial cells, causing direct membrane toxicity and complement activation. Antibody-mediated rejection, donor-specific antibodies will react with human leukocytic antigens, causing a natural killer cell to causing cytotoxic effects, and also bind C1q, activating complement pathway, leading at the end to the formation of membrane attack complex and endothelial damage and thrombus formation. ANCA-associated vasculitis, at first there is priming of neutrophils, movement of myeloperoxidase and the protein A3 to the surface, combining with ANCA antibodies, leading to neutrophil proteases secretion and endothelial damage, reactive oxygen species causing endothelial cell activation, endothelial damage and fibrinoid necrosis. In septic AKI, endothelial cells are both targets and facilitators of kidney damage and sepsis. Endothelial cells are exposed to bacterial components and pro-inflammatory cytokines. Endothelial cells also contribute to increased renal vascular resistance and reduced renal blood flow. Multiple factors such as increased thrombin and dysfunction of the anticoagulation system result in endothelial function. In a typical HUS, as you will note, there is defective in factors that regulate or down-regulate the alternative complement pathway, leading to autoamplification of the alternative pathway and continuous endothelial damage. In preeclampsia, what happens? This is a vascular endothelial growth factor. Vascular endothelial growth factor has three types of receptor. Vascular endothelial growth factor receptor 2 is responsible for its main actions, while its vascular endothelial growth factor receptor 1 is a decoy receptor. It will inhibit it. In preeclampsia, this is called soluble full-length transmembrane protein is vascular endothelial growth factor receptor 1, which is a decoy receptor, is released in 20 to 30 times normal. This will decrease level of vascular endothelial growth factor and leading to endothelial cell damage and podocyte affection. The same while anti-VGF therapy. Diabetic kidney disease, when there is high glucose and there is high reactive oxygen species, the advanced glycosylated end products will bind to its receptors, causing decreased activity of the endothelial nitric oxide synthase with reduced nitric oxide with podocyte food process assessment, detachment, and glycocalyx disruption. In arterial nephrosclerosis, there is reduced nitric oxide, increased endothelin 1 and angiotensin 2 with vessel wall narrowing. In CKD, we'll go in details. There is increased level of ADMA, which causing inhibition for the nitric oxide synthase, decreasing nitric oxide, causing endothelial dysfunction. There is reactive oxygen species released. Superoxide will bind also for nitric oxide, decreasing its levels. In urea, uremic toxins will prevent L-arginine transport inside the cell, which is a substrate for nitric oxide, through inhibition of the cationic amino acid transporter. There have many studies about endothelial dysfunction biomarkers in chronic kidney disease. As we see here in CKD, there is all markers of endothelial dysfunction are more elevated than non-CKD patients. Potential therapies. This is a review article published about endothelial potential therapies for vascular dysfunction, diet, exercise, antioxidant, ACE, ARBs, statins. This is an article about diet and exercise, concluding that an 8-week exercise and Mediterranean diet still improve the endothelial function, and still the improvement is still evident after 1 year. After 1 year, diet or exercise improvement. What about aerobic exercise in CKD patients? Aerobic exercise will stimulate the cationic amino acid transporter to move L-arginine from outside to inside the endothelial cells to synthesize nitric oxide. Also, it will inhibit protein kinase C, which is responsible for the movement of CAT inside cells. Also, what about the antihypertensive drugs? The very recent, yeah, published in 10 TM. كان الconclusion بتاعهم ان الACE والERBs بيimprove الendothelial functions while the CCB والbeta blockers have beneficial effects. Antioxidants, most of the studies use vitamin C ومعظمهم قالوا ان حصل improvement في الendothelial functions. What about vitamin D, CKD? الفيتامين D بيحسن الendothelial function. هذا كان meta analysis و included 4 trials كان فيها 300 عيان. استخدموا 1 to 2 microgram باريكال سيتول لمدة من 12 ل 16 أسبوع والحقيقة أنه حصل improvement في الاندوثيليال فانكشن. أد الستادز كان معظمهم بيقول في فيفر التريت. آخر حاجة هتكلم عليها السونار ترايل which is very important. أدرازنتان is the endothelial receptor antagonist والحقيقة لسه الريزلت بتاعتها كنا مستنيينها وببلشد في شهر مايو اللي فات. في الأدرازنتان جروب لو ان الكومبوزيت رينال اوت كوم سواء دبلنج في سيرم كرياتين او اند ستيج كيدني ديزيز ماتش سيجنيفيكانتلي لوور ذان ذا بلاسيبو يبقى الاترازنتان قلل الريسك اوف دبلنج سيرم كرياتينين ان ستيج كيدني ديزيز. اولسو الجي اف ار ريدكشن اند الكارديورينال كومبوزيت اند بوينت ار لوور اولسو ان ذا اتراسنتان جروب.
دير دكتور يور تايم از اب.
بس هو هل هو كان توتالي سيف؟ لا، الحقيقه كان في بعض سايد افكتس، كان اهمهم الفلويد ريتينشن والكاردياك فيلر والانيميا، كانوا مور سيجنيفيكنتلي في الاتراسنتان جروب عن البلاسيبو. الهوم مسج نيتريك اوكسايد بلايز ا ميجر رول ان سيلال فانكشن. اندوثيليال ديسفانكشن از اسوشييتد ريديوس فازو دايليتيشن برو ثرومبوتيك اند برو انفلاماتوري ستيتس. اندوثيليال ديسفانكشن بلايز ا ميجر رول ان ديفلوبمنت اوف اثيروسكليروز انجيوجينيسيس. ذا كيدني كونتينز دايفيرس بوبوليشن اوف اندوثيليال سيلز. جلوميرول اندوثيليال سيلز ار سوسيبتبل تو انجري ان ميني ديزيز ان ذا كيدني. Increased ADMA and decreased L-arginine availability, oxidative stress, and uremic toxin contribute to endothelial dysfunction and CKD. Diet, exercise, ACEs, and ARB statins, metformin, antioxidant, and endothelial receptor antagonists can improve endothelial dysfunction. وآخر حاجة بس أحب أقول إن مصر فيها حاجات تشرف كتير. اللي فوق ده دكتور محمد العريان، وتم انتخابه رئيس لكلية كوينز في جامعة كامبريدج، ودي ملكة بريطانيا وهي بتكرمه. واللي تحت دولت منتخب الشباب اللي امبارح وصل لكأس العالم، فبرضه في مصر فيها ناس تشرف، مش منتخب الكرة بس يعني. شكرا.